أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين أبو القاسم محمد وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين المعصومين الذين أذهب الله عنهم الرجس وطهرهم تطهيرا. قال الله تعالى في قرآن المجيد، بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: يا أيها النبي إنا أرسلناك شاهدا ومبشرا ونذيرا وداعيا إلى الله بإذنه وسراجا منيرا وبشر المؤمنين بأن لهم من الله فضلا كبيرا. صدق الله العلي العظيم. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي امري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي. اما بعد، السلام عليكم جميعا ورحمة الله وبركاته. I admonish myself first, and then I advise my audience to practice piety, taqwa. There is a dua which is highly recommended to be recited on daily basis. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم: اللهم عرفني نفسك فإنك إن لم تعرفني نفسك لم أعرف نبيك. اللهم عرفني رسولك فإنك إن لم تعرفني رسولك لم أعرف حجتك. اللهم عرفني حجتك فإنك إن لم تعرفني حجتك ضللت عن ديني. Oh Allah, let me know you, because if you do not let me know you, I can never know your prophet. Oh Allah, let me know your prophet, because if you do not let me know your prophet, I can never know your authority. Oh Allah, let me know your authority, because if you do not let me know your authority, I shall deviate from my religion. Indeed, if we can understand this dua, perhaps we cannot memorize. The whole point is that we need to seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to understand Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala through the Holy Prophet, and to understand the Holy Prophet through the Hujjah, that is the Imam, and the Imam of our time, Hazrat Muhammad Mahdi Sahib al-Zaman alayhi salam. About whom we are always told that a person who dies ignorance of his imam, or has not understood his imam, then he dies a death of jahiliyyah. So indeed, it's very important that we do realize these words of dua, which once we have understood, then on day-to-day basis we seek the help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to get his ma'rifah. And his ma'rifah can only be achieved through the Holy Prophet or through the Imams. And the Imams have guided us through the words of the Holy Prophet. So they are all interconnected. When we hear something that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says such and such thing, so there can be no contradiction from the Holy Prophet or the Imams. So anything that comes from the Imams or from the Holy Prophet, that indeed comes from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So our objective in life should be that we should be aiming towards close proximity to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The ayah in question which I have recited, this is from Surah Al-Ahzab, which is Surah number 33, verses 45-47. I've chosen this verse and basically to mention the Holy Prophet, because inshallah we'll be commemorating the Shahada of the Holy Prophet Hazrat Muhammad Mustafa sallallahu alaihi wasallam. I believe on Monday evening, and I thought it would be appropriate to mention something about this holy prophet. Here in this ayah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala addresses, O prophet, indeed we have sent you as a beholder or a witness and a bearer of glad tidings and a warner and as a summoner to Allah by his permission and as an illuminating light, and give glad tidings to the believers that they will have a great bounty from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when we look at the entire life of the Holy Prophet, which he spent for the cause of Islam, the sacrifices which the Holy Prophet had given during his tenure of 63 years or so is immense, and he had to face lots of difficulties, but there he would not be disheartened. And even when he would be disheartened, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala would relieve him, give him glad tidings that you continue with your mission, I am with you. Now, this is a lesson for us also, that anything we pursue in life, the objective should be to get closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We will face situations whereby at times we may have to surrender. We can't carry on, we give up. But if we seek help of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as long as we are sure that what we are pursuing is taking us closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, there is pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. If it is going to displease Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, then we need to forget about it. Then perhaps we are facing those calamities is Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is warning us that don't go through this way, because this is not the way which is going to bring you closer to me. Now, we will look at some of the aspects of the Holy Prophet, but before I go on to that, as I mentioned that his entire life was for the cause of Islam. Now, when it comes to our life, as people are engrossed in their businesses, in their professions, the youths, they attend the unis, the colleges. Indeed, we need to acquire knowledge and pursue further in life. But the religious knowledge also should be given prominence. It should not be ignored at all. Now, I was recently speaking to one brother, and it was regarding, he said, I could, you know, get an early retirement, but what would I be doing? So I said, there's a lot to do. If you just go into the in-depth of the Holy Quran, that is just enough for you, whatever number of years going to stay in life, it's not going to be even complete for you. So, and the retirement is what, 60, 65, 70? After that, how long one is going to live? In the healthy state of mind or healthy body? It's difficult. So, if you take early retirement, as long as there is provision for you for daily bread, then go ahead pursuing learning Quran, go into the in-depth of Quran, study the peak of eloquence or Nahjul Balagha, study Sahifah Sajjadiyah, not only for your own sake, how you can benefit others also. Believe me, these are the things which are going to really enlighten your life, and it is going to enlighten the life of other people around you, and your akhirah is indeed a glorified one. So never feel that you are lonely. And if you feel lonely, then just think that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has decided to send everyone away so that it is you and him, so that you can talk in confidence in private with each other. You want to talk anything in front of him and just blurt it out in front of him. And he is there to exercise patience, because he says exercise patience. And now when you blurt out, let him exercise patience. It doesn't matter, because he is our creator and he understands our weaknesses. Now, in terms of different advices which we find the Holy Prophet conveying to his companions, he used to advise his companions to be generous and merciful to their fellow human beings. Now, generosity is not always in terms of helping people with finance. It's how you can help people in different situations. The simple example I give is giving a smile. That is the best generosity. Even it is considered a sadaqah at times. Salam, of course, sending peace on someone. So if that person has been in a difficult situation, he is in worries, you have sent peace on him, it just, you know, baffles him. He says, who is this person, I mean, to, you know, wish me? And here I'm in my deep thoughts, in my worries, but if your intentions are right, you have sent peace on him with that niya to benefit him, believe me, you will see a change in that person. He will be grateful, he will respond to you, and he will say, believe me, by sending peace on me, you have solved my problem. Can you imagine? He was in worries, how am I going to solve this problem? Just your smile or your just salam has solved his problem. And how much reward you have earned? And then he preached for kindness and high morals. Kindness, generosity, mercy, all these are the qualities of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, I want you to be like me, so what does it mean? It means that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, he is merciful, be merciful. He is generous, you be generous. He is kind, you be kind. And these qualities we find in the Holy Prophet. إِنَّكَ عَلَى خُلُقٍ عَظِيمٍ. He was sent as a rahmah, and also he had the best of the morals, the akhlaqs. And then further we are told that even though he possessed highest status of all men, he was humble and as simple as a common man. When he used to be with the people, a visitor or a stranger would come and he would not be able to distinguish who is the Holy Prophet. Such was his character. The person had to ask from amongst you, who is the Holy Prophet? So such was his stature and his character. And he led a very simple life. And he had no love for luxuries or illusion of the mortal world. And he treated everyone with great respect and considered nobility and honor to be owing to faith, piety, and good behavior. So if you have faith, piety, and good behavior, then rest assured that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will give you respect If Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gives you respect, then that respect cannot be taken away from you by anyone. Rest assured. And people will consider you to be a noble person. They will honor you. They will look you with honor, with respect. And when it comes to respect, it's when you give respect, you get respect. That's very important. If I see somebody younger than me, why should I respect him? We are told that you respect him considering that he has lived less life than you, so there are chances that he has committed less sins. So he is better off compared to you. You must have committed more sins. If you look at the person who is older than you with respect, in that situation, because he has lived longer than you, he has done more good deeds than what you have done. So give him respect. And when it comes to the person of your same level, of your age, then you respect him because you know your shortfalls. You know how sinful you are. You don't know about him. He may appear to be sinful at the face of it, but you don't know behind the scenes how his life is, how he is closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And then he says, he advises his companions to always remember death. Now, death is something which really would change one's life. It's the two things. That's one is Allah and one is death. When I constantly remember Allah, then and seek His help, Ya Allah, You help me. Not only remembering, but seeking His help, then Allah will help me. And if I always remind myself about death, that I am going to end up under the ground, but basically I am going to end up with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. I have been throughout my life with Allah, but in this, the difference between this life and that life is this is just a temporary life, and the veils are there. We, because of that, we are not be able to see what is beyond. Once the veils are removed, and that can only be removed when we have passed away, then we can hear more, we can see more, but we can't do anything more to improve our station in the hereafter. So we need to realize in terms of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the death, and that is imminent. Everyone is going to die. No one escapes. And that is the only way we can go into the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us tawfiq so that we follow in these words of the Holy Prophet, so that we become better Muslims, better lovers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم والعصر إن الإنسان لفي خسر إلا الذين آمنوا وعملوا الصالحات وتواصوا بالحق وتواصوا بالصبر. Alhamdulillah, the period of Arba'een is over now. We have heard the tragic news of the bombs that have exploded in Iraq, in which Zayreen, or the Zawar of Imam Hussein alayhi salam, have been killed. A number of them have been injured. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala raise their station in the grave and the hereafter. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the ziyarah and the ziyarah of those who are there and bring them safely back. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala also bless us so that we are able to perform the ziyarah next year or even before, inshallah. The month of Safar is ending, and I thought it's only appropriate that we do a little bit of masaib in order to pay our respect to the family of the Holy Prophet. After being released from the prison of Sham, Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salatu wassalam and Lady Zainab salamullahi alayha narrated to the people of Sham the tragedy of Karbala and their aftermath sufferings in Kufa and Sham. The caravan then prepared for the journey to Medina via Karbala. As they were about to depart for Karbala, Lady Zainab noticed that Lady Rubab was missing. For a moment, everyone panicked, but then Lady Zainab calmed them and said, "I know where Rubab is." Accompanied by Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, Lady Zainab went to the prison. There was Mother Rubab. She was sitting next to her little daughter's grave. Her arms spread around the grave and her face on the grave with tears pouring from her eyes. She was speaking to her daughter, "My darling Sakina, they all are going back to Medina. I cannot leave you here alone. My darling Sakina, your mother will stay with you. I will not leave you alone in this prison." Lady Zainab said to Mother Rubab, "Oh Rubab, it is time to go home. Please come with us." Mother Rubab looked up at Lady Zainab and what she said, can you hear? "Oh Zainab, did you say home? Where is my home? My husband and baby Asghar lie in Karbala, and my little Sakina lies here in the prison of Sham. My baby Asghar has his father to look after him. But Zainab, my little Sakina, my little girl, she's all alone here. Who will look after her? She has no one here. I cannot leave her here on her own. Please, you can all go and leave me here with my Sakina." Mothers of Sham comforted Lady Rubab and promised her they would visit little Sakina's grave every day. Lady Zainab, with the help of Imam Zainul Abidin alayhi salam, finally managed to persuade Mother Rubab to come with them to Medina. Mother Rubab said, "Khuda Hafiz, Khuda Hafiz, Sakina." Inna lillahi wa inna ilayhi raji'un. Ridham bi qada'ihi wa tasliman li amri. Allahumma al'annab wa la zalimin zalama haqqa Muhammadin wa ali Muhammad. Wa akhira tabi'un lahu ala dhalik. اللهم الإله عن الإصابة التي جاهدت الحسين عليه السلام وشايعت وبايعت وتابعت على قتل اللهم العنهم جميع السلام عليك يا أبا عبد الله وعلى الأرواح التي حلت بفنائك عليك مني سلام الله أبدا ما بقيت بقي الليل والنهار ولا جعله الله آخر الأحد مني لزيارتكم السلام على الحسين وعلى علي بن الحسين وعلى أولاد الحسين وعلى أصحاب الحسين. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين. اللهم صل على سيد المرسلين وشفيع المذنبين محمد صلى الله عليه وآله. الله وعلى إمام المسلمين وقائد الغر المحجلين أمير المؤمنين علي بن أبي طالب صلوات الله عليه وآله وعلى سيدة نساء العالمين وبدعة خاتم النبيين سيدتنا فاطمة بنت رسول الله صلوات الله عليها وعلى الحسن المجتبى صلوات الله وسلم على والحسين الشهيد بكربلاء اللهم صل على وعلى علي بن الحسين ومحمد بن علي وجعفر بن محمد وموسى بن جعفر وعلي بن موسى ومحمد بن علي وعلي بن محمد والحسن بن علي عليهم الصلاة والسلام. اللهم صل على مولانا صاحب الزمان. اللهم صل على ماحي آذان البدع والطغيان، هادم بنية الشرك والنفاق، حاسد فروع البغي والشقاق، صلوات الله وسلامه عليه وعلى آبائه الكرام، ما اتصل الليالي والأيام، اللهم عجل فرجه وسهل مخرجه، وكل ناظرنا بنظرة منا إليه، واجعلنا من المستشهدين بين يديه، وتفضل على أمرائنا المؤمنين بمزيد التوفيقات وازدياد الإقبال وعلو الدرجات. اللهم افعل بنا ما أنت أهله، ولا تفعل بنا ما نحن أهله، بجاه محمد وآله المعصومين صلوات الله عليهم أجمعين. اللهم اجعلنا ممن يذكره فتنفع الذكرى. إن الله يأمركم بالعدل والإحسان وإيتاء ذي القربى وينهى عن الفحشاء والمنكر والبغي يعظكم لعلكم تذكرون. بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. إذا جاء نصر الله والفتح ورأيت الناس يدخلون في دين الله أفواجا فسبح بحمد ربك واستغفره إنه كان توابا. ربنا تقبل منا إنك أنت السميع العليم، وتب علينا إنك أنت التواب الرحيم. بجاه محمد وآله الطاهرين صلواتك عليهم أجمعين.